Hello everybody and welcome back to another Blender Made Easy tutorial. Today we're going to be creating this abstract DNA wallpaper thing using Blender. We'll be using a couple different modifiers and particle systems to get this effect. So in the last tutorial I deleted the default cube and I felt a little bit bad, so today we're going to actually use the default cube. I'm just kidding, you can go ahead and get rid of this default cube, and an easy way to do that in Blender is to click on it, press G to move, and drag it all the way to your desktop. Once you have it on your desktop, go ahead and drag it all the way up to the recycle bin and place it in there to get rid of it. And make sure once it's in the recycle bin to right click and click on empty recycle bin, and that will delete it permanently. Now that our default cube is out of the scene, let's press Shift A and we'll add in a mesh. So click mesh and plane. We're gonna scale this plane down pretty small, so I'll go S, then I'll type in 0.04 and then enter. And I also want it to be placed over here on the left, so what I'm going to do is go into edit mode, then press G, and then X, and drag it over. I went in edit mode because I want the origin point to stay at the center of our scene. That's really important for this next step. Once it's in position, we can go over to the modifier tab, click add modifier, and then click on screw. And here we can see what this is doing. Now, if we turn up the screw amount, it will go up like this, and this gives the shape of the DNA. So I'm probably going to go with a value of 115 right here. That seems pretty good to me. And then the iterations, if I turn that up, we can see it adds another loop to our mesh. I'm also going to set the steps to a value of 32 so it smooths out those edges. I'm not going to worry about the render steps because this object is not going to be visible in the render, so you don't really need to change that. Now we need to duplicate this. So what I'm going to do is press Alt D, then right click, then press R, Z, 180, and then enter. And now we can see that this is starting to look like DNA, and it's looking pretty good. Now let's add in the line going in between these two. To do that, I'm gonna press Shift A, we'll add in a cube, and then I'll scale the cube down to be pretty small, somewhere about there looks good. And then we're going to span it across. So press S, X, and drag it all the way over. That looks pretty good right about there. And now we need to add in a ray modifier to go all the way up. Select your cube, click add modifier and array. Right now it's using the relative offset, so that means it's taking the bounding box of our original cube and positioning the array accordingly. I don't want to use this, so go ahead and uncheck that. What we are going to use is an object offset. So let's go ahead and add in another object. Shift A, we'll add in an empty plane axes. Select your cube, go over to the object offset, turn on that checkbox, and then select the empty. So we can do that by just clicking on the eyedropper tool and selecting it. We can see this happens. Now the reason for this is because we scaled down our cube and Blender thinks that this size is different than what it actually is, so we need to apply the scale. Press Ctrl A and apply the scale, and there we can see it's the proper size. Now if we select our empty, we can drag this up and position our other cube where we want. So I'll drag it up, and I'm going to drag it up about, that looks probably good, about 3 grid units up. Then I'll press R, then Z, and rotate it so that it's inside our screw mesh right here. Now all we have to do is select our empty, select our cube, and turn up the array count, and it will start going all the way up to the top. You might need to, once it reaches the top right there, you might need to mess with the empty a little bit. So if you select it, and then we zoom in over here to the top, we can see it's a little bit offset. So what you need to do is just press R, then Z, and if you hold Shift, you can position it to the way that you want. Right there looks good. So this top one is inside, and we only need 29 of them. All right, there we go. We have our DNA shape. Now let's go ahead and add in a particle system to get the spheres to go all over this. Let's go ahead and do the outside edges first. So select one of them, go over to the particle tab, and then click new. We're gonna be using an icosphere as the particle. So press Shift A, go to mesh, and then icosphere. Scale the icosphere down, and then press G, X, and just get it out of the way somewhere over there. Now with our object selected, I'm going to go underneath render and set the render as object, And then the instant object, I'll just select the icosphere. Now currently nothing's happening. That's because it doesn't realize that this is using a screw modifier, so it doesn't know where to place the particles. Underneath the source, we need to turn on Use Modifier Stack. You also need to make sure that you set this to hair, and once you do that, there you can see all of our spheres are on our mesh. Now that is looking pretty good. What I am going to do is change the scale randomness. I'll just do it a little bit so some of them will be smaller and some of them will be bigger. The number, you can play around with this, but I want almost the entire mesh to be covered in icospheres. So let's try 2000 and see if that works. And that is looking pretty good, and I think I'll stick with that number. Now let's go ahead and apply the same particle system to the other one. So select your other mesh, then hold shift, select this one, hit control L, and then we'll click on modifiers. There we go, and you can see the particle system is now right there. Now for our cube here, I'll just click on new and select that first particle system so we can see our icospheres. Now I do want to make some changes to this, so I'm going to hit that 3 button to give it its own particle system. And then I'm going to set the number, let's try 3000 because there's a lot more mesh. And we'll just double check that that looks good. Maybe a little bit more, let's go 3500. And also I'm going to scale down the icosphere so that the lines in here are smaller than the lines on the outside. So the scale, I'm just going to go 0.02. That is way too small, so let's go 0.04. And I think that looks a little bit better. Since we did that though, there are more gaps in between, so let's turn up the number to 4000. All right, that looks pretty good. And one last thing that we'll do in our particle system is turn off Show Emitter. So this will hide the mesh in the rendered view. Let's go ahead and do the same thing for this one as well. There we go. And then also I'll just do the same for this object here. So select it, turn off Show Emitter. All right, that looks pretty good. Now let's go on to the material for our particles. Select your icosphere and we'll open up a new tab right here. Click on this menu and go to Shader Editor. Click on New. Now for this material, I'm gonna give some of the particles to have a different color, and to do that, we'll be using a particle info node. So press Shift A, go to Input, and then Particle Info. Come on, Blender, there we go, Particle Info. There is an option here for random, and this is the option that we want. To add in some randomness, we need to add in a converter and then color ramp, and here is where we set the color of the particles. So click on random and drag that into the factor, and then the color into the principled shader. For the color, what I'm going to do is just drag the black a little bit over to the right and change this to a dark blue color. So I'll drag this up and give it a dark blue color. Then hit the plus sign, I'm going to drag this over to the left and set this to a lighter blue color somewhere around here. And then the white, that's what I want most of the particles to be. I'm just going to drag this closer so it looks like this. Now if we press Z and go into rendered view, we should be able to see what this looks like. Also, this does not work in Eevee, so make sure your render engine is set to cycles. The particle info node currently does not work. In a future build, it might work. Currently though, if I switch over to Eevee, you can see it's only displaying the dark blue particles. So make sure you're in cycles for this to work. Now here is where you control how many blue ones, how many light blue ones that you want. So if you want less dark blue ones, you just bring that closer, and then you bring this one closer to this. Same thing for the white ones. If you want less white and you want more blue, just drag it over. Play around with this till you get the settings that you want. That looks pretty good to me. Now let's go on to the principled shader. The roughness, I'm going to turn all the way down to 0. The metallic, I'm going to bring all the way up to a value of 0.8, so it has a nice glossy look. The next thing that we need to do is set the background, so go ahead and go over to the world settings, set the color to a sky texture, and set the strength of this to a value of 0.1. There we go, that looks pretty good. For the lighting, what I'm going to do is add in a plane, so go back into solid view, shift A will add in a plane, go into front view and I'll rotate it so that it's facing upwards, and then I'll scale it up as well. Place it over here. This will emit light into our scene and give our icosphere something to reflect. Now that it's in place, let's go ahead and give it a new material with an emission shader. You can leave the strength at 1 and the color as white. Another thing I want to add is a sun lamp. So select your lamp here, change it to a sun lamp, set the strength of this to a value of 20, and then go into top view. I'll rotate it this way, and something like that looks pretty good. Now let's position the camera. So for the camera, I want it to be at an angle. So what I'm going to do is go into front view, hit Control Alt 0 to snap the camera into place. I'll right click on it and then rotate it. You can position this however you want. I'm probably going to go something like this. I think will look pretty good. Press Z and go into render view to see what that looks like. All right, there we go. Now what we need to do is add in some depth of field to really sell the scene. To do that, you can add in an empty, so hold shift and then right click to snap your cursor right about there. Shift A will add in another empty object. Select your camera, click on depth of field, the focus object will go empty 001, and set the focus amount to 0.4. If we press Z and go into rendered view, we should see that we have some nice depth of field. That looks pretty good. Now, another thing that I want to do is add multiple of these DNA strands in other places. So to do that, I'm going to select everything. So B, box select all the objects, deselect the camera, make sure that it's selected properly, which it is. Then I'm going to go into top view, shift D, and place it in the background. Go back into camera view and place this how you want. Now currently it's rotated the exact same way. You can see the rotation is exactly the same. I want it to be a little bit different, so I'm going to hit R, Z, and just rotate it something like that. Maybe rotate it this way as well. We'll see what that looks like. Go into render view, toggle overlays, and that looks pretty neat. The depth of field I might turn up a little bit more. Let's go 0.3 to just blur that out a little bit more. That looks pretty good. Then one more thing that I want to do is add another one closer to the camera. Alt D, and I'll just place it over here. Go into camera view, I'll scale this down, I'll rotate it and just place it how I want, something like that. All right, I'm happy with that result. That looks pretty neat. So now let's get into the render settings. First off, I'm gonna go over to the color management and set the look to medium low contrast, just to give the whole thing a little bit more contrast. Then go over to the scene panel and turn on denoising. If you have the denoise for the NVIDIA card, you can use that one. I found that one works a little bit better. So you can go ahead and turn that on and then render out your image. All right, our render has finished and this is our result. And as you can see, it does look pretty good, but there's still a couple of things that we could do to improve this image. First off, what we're gonna do next is add in some dust particles that are kind of like floating around here, doing a little bit of color grading, adding a vignette, and just a couple more things. Now you could do this in Blender, but it's so much easier in a program like Photoshop or GIMP. So what we're gonna do now is go over to one of those programs if you have them and finish out the render. All right, here we are in Photoshop. Now you can do this step in Blender if you wanted to, but I tried it once and it's just, there's no control over where the particles are blurred and it gets really complicated really quick in the compositor. So it's much easier to do this with another program like Photoshop or GIMP. All right, so the first thing that we need to do is a little bit of color grading to help make our image stand out a little bit more. So you can go ahead and select your layer over here and convert it to a smart object. Smart objects means that you can add a filter or do anything and it will be non-destructive. You can always go back to the original image. Next, go over to the camera raw filter up here at the top, and then we'll just change the color a little bit. First thing that I'll do is I'll turn the temperature down so that it has a more blue color. A value of -8 is pretty good. The exposure I'll drag up, the contrast I'll drag up, and the texture and the clarity I'll drag up as well just to sharpen up the image. The vibrance I'll turn up as well just to give the overall color a little bit more saturation. And then finally, within the FX, we're going to drag the vignette down to darken up the corners, and the midpoint, which is where the darkness actually starts, I'm going to drag that up so it's a little closer to the corners. Something like that looks pretty good. Once you're happy with that, click OK, and it will take a second to render, and here we can see our result. And as you can see, if I turn it off and then on, it looks a lot better. The next thing to do is to add in the dust particles. Now this step is pretty easy. We're just gonna go a new layer right here, and we're gonna be using a brush. Now the brush that we'll be using is a snow brush, and the link to this is down in the description if you wanna go download that. Now to enable your brush tool, you can hit B on your keyboard, and as you can see, I already have the brush installed. To install a brush, you can go up to this menu, click on this button here, and then just click on Import Brushes. Once you've imported them in, you can see down here all sorts of different brushes. The one that we'll be using is this one here. Once you have it selected, it'll look something like this. Then all we have to do is just click on a certain spot, and that will add in a lot of particles. And I'll just do this, and I'll just fill out the scene something like this. There we go. And as you can see, it's a little strong right now, so I'll turn the opacity down quite a bit so it's not too crazy. Something like that, probably 40%. Now we do need to add some blur to this. Now you could go over to the blur tool right here, the blur tool, scale up and just start to blur out those edges. That's a little strong. I'll turn the strength down. Something like this, and just start to draw around where you want it to be blurred out. So probably here will look good. I'll blur out the foreground, and I'll leave the part in the middle to be a little bit more not blurry, because that's what's in focus. Something like this will look pretty good. All right, there we go. So there's our result. And as you can see, if I turn the particles off and then on, it really gives it a nice cool effect. So there you go, guys. That is the end of this tutorial. Thank you for watching. If you learned something new or created your own image, I'd love to see it. So make sure to send it to me over on Instagram. Also, make sure you like, comment, and subscribe for more tutorials just like this one. And I'll see you guys in the next video. Thanks again, and goodbye.